everyone. My name is Kampanat. Please give me a few seconds to calm down a bit, because I just learned last week that we have to conduct the speech in English. So wonderful. I'm a robot engineer, so I have a long experience of integrating robot, more than 20 years now. And one thing I can share with you is what I have learned for the past 20 years is robot is quite stupid machines. So it's not like what you have seen in the movie. You can tell it to do something and it will start doing it. It's not. You have to pre-program the robot. And the good thing is robot will listen to you. It will follow your program. It will keep repeating the program endless day and night without making any mistake. But that is it. It's good for repetitive tasks. Cannot do anything else. How to use this one. So robot technologies is not new. It's quite old. So people using robot in many applications, like picking up cement bags, cutting, welding, painting. There's many jobs that robot are doing, but the thing is they are using the robot mainly wherever you can do a mass productions. So in the construction industry where the two buildings, they are not the same, or even if they are the same, the owner would try to make you ask you to do something different anyway. So robot is not so popular yet in the construction industry because you need something that can adapt and able to work in what we call a one-piece productions. So you build something one piece, and then the next project you change again. But robot cannot do that. That's why it remain in this area. Just to give you example, ปิดเสียงหมดเลยได้ไหมครับ One of the example, ปิดหมดได้เลยครับ This is called press tending. The robot job is very simple, moving from left to right, picking up some work piece and put into the machines. It's one of the popular work that we like robot to do instead of human because it's quite boring and it's quite dangerous also. So imagine the workers moving the work piece day and night, just left to right, and then if he becomes sleepy and decide to sleep inside the machine, then he will have a good dream. So this is one of the area where we use a robot a lot, in the area where it's quite dangerous. The next area, as in this example, is when we need to do something at a very high speed. So in this example, the robot is packing a condom at the speed of 300 packages per minute. It's very fast, and this customer actually asked us to build many systems like this, so you can imagine how many condoms we're going through every day. One thing I would like you to notice is the robot itself, as I say, is very stupid. It cannot work by itself. So you see there's a lot of peripheral equipment that we build and install around the robot just to make him happy and make sure that he can work correctly. If there's something move, something change, the robot will not notice that and he will keep moving to the same position and result in the collisions. The last area where people are using robot a lot is in the high precision applications like laser cutting, welding, anything that you like to robot to follow the path correctly. So this is the area where we use the robot a lot as well. So if robot can weld, why don't we use it to build constructions components like a steel structure? There's a company who is doing that right now. I took this photo from their website, so I think this should be okay. Legally should be okay. If you look at the top picture, you see there's a lot of robot there with the fixture equipment that looks so complicated. The job of this robot is to build a house for us, But unfortunately, you cannot ask him to build any house you want. It only built a house based on a certain configuration, a certain dimension only. It has a very limited capability, let's say. You cannot ask him to build anything you want. So this is a problem that I have seen for many years, and it's one of the reasons why some of the jobs are still there. The robot cannot replace some job yet. But that is about to change because some crazy company like us, that we're trying to replace more and more jobs. So we look at how the human can do the task and how can we give the same abilities to the robot. So first of all, when we do some work, most of the time we use our eyes to see things and then we decide what to do. So we invest a lot in vision systems. And then imagine if you do something without looking, you actually relying on your touch sensing. So you may grab something, you can feel that it's in your hands, or some delicate work like sanding, polishing, you need to control the force to make sure that you're doing the work correctly. So at our company, we are giving robot these two capabilities. And then we have an AI team. We have a data scientist and AI engineer to develop a software. What do we use it for? The software is collecting the data from touch sensing and the vision system. And it's combined those two information together. Then he figured out, okay, based on this new situation, what should I do? The AI software evaluates situation, then he creates a new robot program in real time. So AI software, based on those info, he will send the new program to robot. And now robot able to do things by using the eyes and the touch sensing. Let's give you more examples. The first example is how vision can guide robot to do some things that is, the position is changing all the time. This is from our lab, maybe 10 years ago. So in this example, we built our own 3D camera. You see the white camera there, and we have a laser light projector at the bottom. Back then, the 3D camera is not ready available, so we built ourselves. And in this example, the robot scanning the workpiece, he able to capture 3D image. And then he's trying to locate those square brackets to find out where it is, and then precisely position our mimic tools, pretending to weld the workpiece. And after this, our staff will move this workpiece, and then robot look at it again, and then reprogram himself to weld it. I'm sorry, I cannot fast forward the video. Ah, okay, here comes the hands. Let's give it one more time to see if he moved the workpiece. Okay, now, so it's moved to a new position. Just one look, and then he'll be able to follow the bracket again. So that's how we can use the eyes to help robot work. What about the touch sensing? We cooperate with a company from Austria who developed a device to enable robot to control the force. And when robot able to control the force, what can we do with it? This is one of the example. In this very expensive car company, they would like to make sure that all car has a nice paint, nice finish. So in order to have a nice paint, you have to have a nice surface preparations. So they use the robot together with the force control to do the sanding work and make sure that all the surface are nicely prepared. So those are two examples now. The first one is when we add the vision to robot, what can it do? And now we're adding the touch sensing, the force control to robot. But the robot's still moving in the same path. It's just moving, following the pre-programmed position. It doesn't do anything else. But what if we want robot to do something more difficult? We need to give him a brain, and that's why we add AI software to the robot. So now we combine three technologies. First one is the vision, second one is the force control, and the last one is the AI software. In this particular application, we built for one of the clients in Thailand. Our job is to repair a gas cylinder. So I think everyone who live in Thailand are familiar with this gas cylinder. You know that they get thrown around, bent, become rusty, and they change the shape, and we need to repair it automatically. So the first step is on the bottom left corner, the robot needs to cut off the old base. And then he has to do the grinding to make sure the surface is smooth, then adding the new workpiece and weld it. So all of this is done with the vision system, force control, and the software, because as I say, the tank, none of them look the same. So the only way to be able to do this is for robot to be able to reprogram himself based on the product present to him. So on the top right corner, you see the 3D image from our 3D camera. Robot is able to locate those welding line and also measure the curvature of the tank so he can position the plasma cutting torch properly so he can cut off the base without blowing off the bottom. So the next process, we then scan the tank again for the leftover material. We measure the thickness, measure the length, and calculate and probably design how much force is required to grind those off. And we cannot overgrind them because then this gas cylinder will be too thin to use. So we have two-step grinding. After finished grinding, we will end up with a very smooth surface. And the next process is then to weld it with the new base. You can see the surface is now very smooth. Now we add a new base. And we never know where the two pieces will join together because we have a new base and a very old tank. So again, we have to scan it with our 3D camera and try to locate where the two pieces join together. Then in real time, generate a program and tell robot where to go and weld the workpiece. So now finish scanning and he start welding. So you might ask, hey, this is look very nice, but it's nothing to do with the construction industry. Can we apply this technology in the construction? Yes, people are doing it now, and they're doing it a lot so that it is almost like a standard product now. This application is from my friends in China. They use the same technologies to scan. I don't know what is this workpiece for, but it's for some heavy steel constructions. What they need to do is just putting the workpiece in front of robot and tack weld each piece is in the positions. Then robot look at the workpiece and then he decide by himself where he should go and weld. You see there's no expensive jig fixture to clamp the workpiece in position. Just place it there and see how nice robot can weld. So if your job is to build a heavy steel structure, this is a solution. It's not only it can weld the flat components, it can follow any shape. You can place a curve shape like this in front of the robot, and it will weld. So with the visions and the software now, it slowly enable the construction process to be able to automate like this. Not only it can weld, but it can also cut as well. We're using the same technologies, but this time, when you prepare a thick metal piece before welding, sometimes we need to do what they call beveling. So using the same technologies, you just place a workpiece in front of the robot and tell him the parameter, how you would like to bevel the workpiece, what angle, what is the thickness, and robot will look at the workpiece and say, okay, I will do it. Then he will go and do beveling. This is readily available. You don't need to do any development. So for my final example, let's say that those examples from the beginning, they are the robot which we built to replace a blue-collar jobs, a very low-income workers, labor workers. So the return on investment is quite difficult. And there's many other jobs related to the construction that you need to do before you're actually building it. For example, making a design, which the previous speaker already mentioned that you can use the software to design the house. And checking the drawing, making a bill of material. So there's many things you can do before you actually go and build it. This is actually done by a very professional people with a high income. So now we're working with this customer to help those people work faster. Look at this pipe oil and gas structure. After they make a design, they spend a lot of time with the team of professionals to check every single page to make sure that the design is correct. After that, they pass the drawing to the next department where they check every page again to make sure that they have the right list of the, they call material takeoff, I think, but for me, I call it bill of material, and so on and so forth. So they say that, can the AI do this for us? So we took the challenge. So this project name is the P&ID drawing. We check the P&ID drawing and we verify and give the report. This is a very simple request from our customer. We would like to give your robot a drawing, and then we want to ask them some answer. And we hope the robot can give us answer, can check the drawing for us, can do many things for us, much like a ChatGPT. So the basic idea is, first of all, the software must be able to read all those drawings. So we first develop a software to convert all the drawing into a digital format. And after that, we pass those info to the AI software who do a certain checking and then give the report back to the customer. The drawing looks like this. So you have some symbols here, you have lines. Some of the symbols have labels which telling you what they are, but in the very short form. And let's say if you want to know more details about this symbol, you then have to look at the top right corner for the note to look for the matching number and read the descriptions. Those descriptions usually enter by an engineer. So each person, they have different style of typing. So our AI software must be able to understand those as well. So it's pretty much understand the human language. And then we check the bottom right corner to see that each boxes have the right information. How to do this? We use a lot of AI technologies to do this. We use the OCR to extract the characters. We then use the natural language processing to to make sense of those sentences that they put on the drawing, and we use the computer vision to extract the symbols and line, and not only to understand each symbol, we have to know the position of each component as well. For example, what is marked in blue, the software detects them as a text. And then the green color is the symbols. Red color is the line. It knows what this component is, and it also knows where is the positions. The software learning from a standard set of symbols, but we can keep adding on it because each company has different design, different standards, so we can add more symbols to the drawing. We can even do a checking on other type of drawing, not just oil and gas, we can do on electrical drawing as well. So first step, after we extract and convert all this into digital form, we start to read and make sense of all those border informations, reading all the text, make sure they are correct. And if we found something that is not correct, like we found out that they forgot, maybe when they start, they just put note 10 so that the future they can come back and fix it, but they forgot. So the software will then flag that say, hey, this page, there's something wrong. And here is a recommendation. Would you like the software to fix it for you? So our software can read all those texts in the border and recommend the give a suggestion of what should be correct. After we scan each page, in order to give a better support, we have to have the overall picture of the whole system. So the software then need to connect each page to build the full 3D image in his brain. This is done by reading what they call a line continuity. So at the end of each page or each line, sometime if the line continue to the next page, you have to put some kind of label to say, hey, my line is connecting to that page. And when the project become large, you have lots of line continuing and sometimes you make a mistake. So the first step to build this 3D image in the head is the software will check for all the line continuities. And if he found something wrong, again, we will flag the user and say, hey, there's a mistake between this page and that page. Please go and fix it. Once we have the full picture, we can start to answer more questions. For example, please compare the ISO drawing to the PID drawing. If they are the same, we're checking everything like a pipe number, line number, material specification. We make sure that the PID and the ISO number, ISO picture is the same. Time is up, so I will quickly, we have just 2-3 more pages. And then the procurement can run the software again and check to make sure that the material, the component list is correct. So in this page, is the software able to detect and count how many valve or how many whatever this equipment is? And then he check against those text on the right-hand side if the number, the quantity, and the type, the description is correct. And then based on this, he will go and update the MTO list. So at the end, the software are able to generate a full correct bill of material for you to do the procurement. This is the future work. The software is now able to check the design against the user manuals, against the company's specification. Like in this example, this company designed it for the certain size of pipe, you need a certain size of the support or spring. So it will check all those for you. So that's my final example, how we can use software to help not only the blue collar work, but also do something complicated like this. And I like to encourage everyone to pay more attention to AI, because if you don't embrace them and use them to empower yourself, one day some crazy company like me will replace you.